Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us this morning. If you please join me in prayer. Lord God, receive our prayer and thanksgiving for the blessings, help, and comfort which you bestowed upon your people in this place from its foundation. Continue, we pray, we may your many mercies in your church, that we may be conscious at all times of your unchanging love, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please pay undivided attention to our wonderful senior bell choir.
Good morning. Happy anniversary, St. Paul. Will you please stand as we sing?
Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done on earth as Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb. For the sins of the world, his blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow for the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before him. So open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. The God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fire. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 Who can stop the Lord? Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, it awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Between us, by the cross you came and broke them down. You broke them down. There were chains around us. By your grace we are no longer bound. No longer bound. You called me out from the grave. You called me into the light. You is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens me. Feel the darkness shaking. All the dead are coming back to life. I'm back to life. Hear the song awaken. All creation singing, we're alive. Because you're alive. You call me out from the grave. You call me into the light. You call my name and then my heart came alive. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, it awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. What a love we found. Death can't hold us down. We shout it out. We're alive.
We make our beginning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lead a life worthy of the calling to which you are called. Lead a life worthy of your calling, a life filled with service and meekness. Lead a life which reflects your calling, that life of peace grounded in the Spirit. Live a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called. Please be seated. We gather here this morning to give thanks and to praise God for the many blessings in our lives. Acknowledge our dilemma. We are an impure people coming before a pure God. And we acknowledge in this time of confession that our thoughts are far from pure, our words are less than holy, and our deeds, they are not always pleasing in God's sight. We come before Him now in silent confession. It is true, every last one of us to a person, we're impure. Our thoughts are not right. Our deeds are not right. Our heart often is not right. This is the reality of sin. And yet, let me remind you of the reality of grace. And grace is this. We come this day as an impure people, coming before a perfectly pure God. And at the cross, God exchanges all this. He sends His one and only Son into this world to do for us what we cannot do for ourselves. And because of God's mercy and His great love, all our sins are forgiven at that cross. It is my great privilege to remind you again this day, your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with our readings.
Please join me in our responsive readings based on Colossians 3, Romans 12, 1 Corinthians 3. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all of the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ.
For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free. And we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many.
As it is, there are many members, yet one body. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it.
Now you are the body of Christ, and individually members of it.
There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all.
According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building on it. Each builder must choose with care how to build on it, for no one can lay any foundation other than the one that has been laid. The foundation is Jesus Christ.
The epistle reading is from 1 John chapter 3. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know Him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when He appears, we shall be like Him, because we shall see Him as He is. And everybody who thus hopes in Him purifies himself as He is pure. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 5th chapter.
Glory to you,
Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of words of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated.
At this time, I'd like to invite all the children who are here to come forward for a children's message. Good morning, my friends. How are you doing this morning? Doing all right? Yeah. Anyone know what we're here to celebrate today? Yeah, what, Alex? The what was that? 125th anniversary of our church. Yeah. Yeah. How many of you have ever had a birthday before? Yeah. Okay, good. Good. So you know a little bit about this, right? And what do we do at birthdays? We celebrate. What do we... Yeah, Annie, what do you do? We have cake. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, what else do we do? Open up presents.
Have surprises.
Have surprises.
But what we really need is God.
But what we really need is God. And message is over. Good job, Olivia. Yeah, wonderful, wonderful. Yeah, what I want to say today is this is much like a birthday party. You enjoy birthday parties? I enjoy birthday parties, right? This is much like a birthday party. We're celebrating that as a church family, we've turned 125 years. As my friend Olivia said, this is what we really celebrate today. We celebrate that God is so good, right? God is so good that he just continues to bless us, right? And he gives us a new year, right? A new year to go out and do what God only knows. Right? And so today we gather and we celebrate. We sing a lot, right? We sing a lot because we are filled with joy. And you know what? There will be cake after church. So it's, yeah, right? Right? But today as we gather, right, we celebrate God and his blessings. And we thank him. We thank him for all that has gone before us, for our time, and everything that will come next. I just want to encourage you, that's a good way to celebrate a birthday too, right? Ever think about that, right? That on our birthdays, we should be praising God. We should be celebrating God for all the good things he's given to us. Yeah.
My favorite kind of cake is chocolate.
Make a note of that. I think there is some chocolate cake, my friend. All right, will you please pray with me? Let's take our hands and fold them, take our eyes and close them. You can repeat after me. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day and the chance to celebrate 125 years. God, you are so good. Let us praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. You are the best, my friends. You may follow Mrs. Kruger out for sermon art right now if you'd like, or you may go back to your seats. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, who is Jesus Christ. Amen. So what was the birthday that just snuck up on you? You know, the one that you were not really thinking about until all the celebrations were over, and then all of a sudden it hit you. How did I get this old? Right? Was it your 21st or your 40th or your 65th or your 80th? Imagine waking up one day and being 125. Or maybe you're there. Right? Today, we gather in worship because we're here to celebrate 125 years for our church family. And when you think about that, in some ways, that truly is an amazing run. That is amazing. And in other ways, it feels like just a blink of an eye. Today we come together for the purposes of thanking and praising God for the way in which He has blessed this church family so richly, and the ways in which He's used this church family to be a blessing to our community. Our gospel lesson that was shared this morning, it illustrates for us how God blesses. It's the opening of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes. Jesus promises blessings on His disciples, and they feel, as we hear them, like beautiful, gentle, merciful words that He speaks. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are the pure in heart. It seems significant to me that when you really look at the way that Matthew has structured his gospel account to us, that the Beatitudes are shared almost directly after Jesus calls his disciples. What this means is that Jesus talks about their blessings to come before the disciples accomplish anything. He talks about the good things God has in store for them before they make any serious sacrifices. He talks about all the plans of God on their behalf before they demonstrate an amazing loyalty. And I would suggest that that is the heart of God for our blessing. He blesses us because of who He is and not because of what we've done. This is how Jesus will lead His disciples, and this is the way that God has faithfully led this church since its inception. This is the grace of God. It is the treasure that has been entrusted to all of us here at St. Paul. Now, I would suggest to you, as we think about what has been and what will be, that St. Paul as a church family has been able to distinguish itself in this community, in the area of Christian education, and when it comes to demonstrating generosity, and also when it comes to serving the community. But central to every good thing we have here is the treasure of God's grace. We know that God, in His love, sent His one and only Son into this world on a saving mission, and that Jesus' crucifixion isn't just a moment in time that we can point to remember how God loves us, but that Jesus' crucifixion is an act of love that continues to love us wherever we're at. Grace is found in that God's love comes well before our response. In understanding that the God who formed us desires to be the God who redeems us. And therefore, our message to this community, to everybody we have the privilege to meet, follows that 1 John declaration. See what kind of love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. This grace understanding changes everything. This understanding of God's grace given to us, it makes everything different. Because we do not have to live as people who are trying to earn God's love. And we don't have to go through this life with the weight of wondering if we've done enough, if our lives have been good enough. Right? It completely changes the tone and the tenor of this anniversary. Because today we are not waking up after 125 years and wondering, has this experiment called St. Paul, has it turned out all right? Have we lived out the dreams of those who have gone before us, the originals who gathered in faith to begin this church? We don't have to wonder if collectively we have done enough to merit God's favor. Instead, today what we do is we look back at everything that's happened in this place and we say, our God is great. Our God is so awesome, and His love for us is without compare, and His passion for the people in this community is our strength. It was just 2 years ago, as a church family, we read through something that's called the story. And the story is a narrative version of Scripture. And in the story, the authors do a really good job of pointing out what is the upper story and what is the lower story. And the lower story is all about what the people are going through, what the people are doing. For example, we read about Moses trying to lead the people through a period of wandering and all the strains and the stresses and the struggles that came with that challenge. And everything that Moses had to do to lead a stubborn people. The upper story of the same time period is all about what God is doing. When we look at it, we see God's amazing patience, His mercy, His love for His people as they wander, and His ability to use everything that they go through ultimately to the blessing of His creation. So this weekend, as we gather here, as we celebrate 125 years, of course, we're going to highlight and celebrate a lot of lower story stuff. Moments like building milestones or membership celebrations, the number of people we've been blessed to see and come into the family of God through baptism, how many marriages have begun here, how many moments of sadness where the community came together to support one another, how many ministries have come and gone in our time. And as excited as we rightly are about where we've been and where we're headed and what's going on right now, the reason that this moment is actually a moment of worship is because the greatest thing that we have to claim is all about what God is doing and what He's been doing from the beginning and what He will do into the future. Right? So what will people say about our time and what we've contributed 125 years from now? Or, let's say it another way, what will this look like when all the excitement fades away? Well, my hope is that we will continue always to be a family committed to knowing Jesus and growing in Jesus and sharing Jesus with this community. I realize this, Lutherans, we tend to be a self-deprecating bunch. We've all heard the joke about how many Lutherans does it take to change a light bulb, and we know that the answer is change, right? Why would we change? But have you heard the one about the Lutheran who actually became a Catholic? This is pretty fascinating. There was a Lutheran man who moved into an all-Catholic neighborhood, and he did so during the season of Lent. And on his first Friday in his new house, he went out to his patio and he began grilling a steak. And the smell of that steak went all through the neighborhood, and it got the attention of his neighbors. As you know, good Catholics do not eat meat on Fridays in Lent. Needless to say, they were not particularly happy with their new neighbor. Well, the next Friday rolls around, and sure enough, the same thing. And the smell of that steak is so much that it drives them crazy. And they all gather together and they develop a plan. Their plan is this: they are going to, as a community, they are going to proselytize to this man. And so they begin with deliveries of cookies. And then they start bringing his mail to the door just so they can say hello. And then some of them offer to help weed his gardens. And then finally, the final move, Father O'Malley makes an unannounced visit. And when he does, success. He convinces the Lutheran to convert to Catholicism, to become a Catholic. And they expedite the whole process so they can confirm him next Thursday. And when Father O'Malley gathers in the gentleman's house, when everything is done, he places his hand over him and he says this. He says, "You were born a Lutheran. You were raised a Lutheran. But today, you are a Catholic." And the community rejoiced. The temptation they knew now was gone. And they all celebrated and went their separate ways. And then it was the next day, Friday. And all of a sudden, that familiar smell of steak was in the air again. And everybody in the neighborhood, exasperated, they came and they gathered around the man's fence until one of them garnered the strength and the courage to lift another up so they could look and see what was going on. And sure enough, there stood their most recent convert at his grill again, flipping a thick, juicy, sizzling porterhouse steak on his grill. And they watched as the man stretched his hand over the steak and he said, "You were born a cow. You were raised a cow, but today you are a fish." And the point of the story is this: there is just something in our DNA, something about us, whether it's by birth or in upbringing, that makes us resistant to change. So what does our future look like? It's a question that's come up an awful lot lately. What does our future look like? Well, I would say today is a good day to really consider that. As we gather and we tell stories about the things that have been, the reality is this: our future will probably look an awful lot like our past. And my prayer is this, right? That the consistency won't be about a stubborn, stiff-necked way. And that our unchanging identity won't be a lack of care or love for the community and what anyone we meet is going through. Instead, it will be all about an unwavering proclamation of the gospel and a heart to continue meeting people where they're at with the grace of God. Because this church is here because it's led by Jesus. And his mission and his ministry don't change and won't change until he returns to take us home to be with him. When we stop, like we're doing today, to consider our past, we just have to count our many blessings that God has given to us. And when we look to the future, we do so in complete confidence of the certain blessings that are to come. Because that is the grace of God for all of us. It is all blessings on top of blessings. Amen. Will you please join me as we share together the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. Word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace.
We remember this day, the brave and believing people who brought God's message to this place. Let us not forget them. By their energies, this congregation was gathered, given order, built up, and continued. Follow as they followed in the way, truth, and life of Jesus Christ, the head of the church. We now remember those saints who have gone before us in this last year. Elmer Van Orden. Robert Sutliff. Joe Rossman. Thomas Coyle. Tom Harris. Don and Carol Peterson. Justin Goodwin. Linda Sanders. David Beeler. Janet Havens. Cheryl McQueen. Chris Eggleston, Lois Redmond, Marla Humans, Wanda Radke. Lord, we remember the faith of those from long ago. We honor their courage, their wisdom, and determination on this day of celebration. We stand on the shoulders of many clouds of witnesses. We bring to you our time, our talents, and money to continue the work that you began with our ancestors. We stand in the middle of greater possibilities. You have carried us through many dangers and toils and snares. Eyes have not seen, nor ears heard, neither have entered the heart of men and women, things which you have prepared for those whom you love. We bring all we have to you. Use it to continue the work that you started long ago. Amen. Gracious God, use this offering that it may be a blessing to all those who are able to come to know you more. Lord, we pray the continuation of your kingdom in this place and beyond. Amen. Together, we bring forward the prayers of the church. Today, we pray for all those who mourn. We especially lift up to God John Humans and his family following the passing of his wife Marla. We pray for Sally Littlefield and her family following the passing of her mother Wanda. We pray for those recovering from surgery, for Dave and for Cheryl. We pray for Melanie Zoller as well, recovering from surgery. We continue to pray for Heather and Jim and Troy. O Lord, faithful God, we commend ourselves, our bodies and souls, and all things to your keeping. And deliver us in your righteousness from all that would harm the body or assault the soul. Almighty God, send your Spirit to the ministers of the church who bring the good news of Christ's death and resurrection, that they may work through the preaching of this gospel to gather the lost, to kindle faith in those who do not yet believe, and to sustain us all to the day of Christ's coming. Gentle Lord, visit the homes of your people, that they may be places where faith is nurtured and where we learn to live our new lives in holiness and righteousness. Heavenly Father, comfort us by your abiding presence and satisfy all who call out to you in need, especially this day. We pray for Sally and her family. We pray for John and his family. We pray for Marnie in hospice, for Dave and Cheryl and Melanie recovering from surgeries, for Margot and Heather, for Jim and Troy, for Barb and Kaya, for Carol and Charlotte, for Zachary and Eddie and Chris and Bryson and Sarah, for Monica and Carol and Jackie and all those struggling with cancer. We call out to you now with the names of those who are on our heart. God, grant them patience in the midst of suffering, and according to your will, release them from their afflictions. Heavenly Father, grant that we may be brought into everlasting life with the faithful who have gone before us, who now rest from their labors. And Almighty Father, though we are unworthy of your saving grace, we pray you to hear us in the name of Jesus, in whom, with whom, and through whom all honor and glory is yours, Heavenly Father, with the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And together we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he'd given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, and when he'd given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often you remember me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer now ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will rise again. We will take communion today as a continuous line. That means we'll form a line that'll go right down the center aisle here, and then you'll split out to the sides and return to your seat that way. Take and eat. May the Lord bless and keep you this day and always. Take and eat the body of Christ. This is the true body. This is the bread of life. The body of Christ, which is given for you. Take and eat the body of Christ. Take and drink the blood of Christ shed for you. Take and drink. This is the true blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink the blood of Christ, which is given for you. Take and drink. Now may this true body and true blood strengthen and preserve you in true faith till life everlasting. Amen. Thank you.
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres.
Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty
shelter.
the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Though my heart and flesh may fail. there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God.
Let us pray. Renew our communion with all those who in times past have worshiped visibly and in this holy place and now worship here invisibly. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, strengthen us to run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Here's our announcements for the week, and it's one. I'm not going to shake your hand after church, unless you come down to the gymnasium. Come down, then I'd be happy to shake your hand. If you did not sign up to join us for lunch, still join us for lunch. Right? If you did not bring something, still join us for lunch. Don't leave. We would love to have you. We have so much to praise and thank God for and so many great stories to tell. We'd love to have you immediately following the service if you're able to join us down in the gymnasium. And with that, I ask that you please stand as we sing together our sending song. I invite all the children who are here to come forward, grab a ribbon, and help lead us in the final song.
Trumpet call, live
You go nowhere by accident. Wherever you go, God is sending you. Wherever you are, God has put you there. Christ, who dwells in you, has something he wants to do through you where you are. Believe this and go in his grace and love and power. And now go in peace. Serve the Lord.